Okay, so we start with what we were talking last time, continuing with some little more about DFAM, though actually DFAM needs much more explanations. I will start working on DFAM's frequency response later after this 2 days, after the exam, and that time I will show you more problems of DFAM designs. So let us start with the present day problem, which is not really present in the last 15 years, 10 years I can say. We have been working with short channel devices. And I repeat for those who have forgotten, a short channel device is defined as if the channel length of the device is comparable to the source drain junction depth or almost of equal to the depletion layer width in the gate region. Is that clear? If they are comparables, then we say device is in short channel. Okay. Essentially the way scaling goes, that we scale the dimensions of the device, let us say from the depletion layer width below the channel and the junction depth of source and drain. Okay. Either of them are comparable to channel length, then we say device is in short channel. The problem with short channel, as I say, when you scale length and width, the problem is it creates a lot of problem on linearity, which is essentially the output currents. And we will like to see then what happens. But please remember, scaling is more relevant because the voltage, we normally do what we call voltage scaling. If we do field scaling, that means all voltage length, everything scales, then there is no problem, everything is scalable. But that is not possible because the power supply values are not decided by scaling people, it is decided by system people. So we started with 5 volt, 3.3 volt, 2.1 volt, 1.5 volt, 1.2 volt, 1 volt. 0.8 volt. So this is not something which I can decide, this is someone else is going to decide. If I scale then the voltage to length ratio or fields will be larger because voltage will not scale as much as the lengths will scale. And there is the issue where it creates problem for performance. Typically few, of course there are many short channel effects you must have done in many other courses. I just list for something which hurt me in this course. One other problem I see is the mobility variation due to the fields, because both EX, EY increase. There is also a problem of VT reduction as the channel length goes down. Of course, there is another issue, some other device person will know that we have come very close to 90 nanometers or around. There is an increase of VT, this is called rebounds. So there are issues there also. If you are in that region, you will have to take care of your VT much more. Then there is an increase of source drain resistances. The reason is, as I just now said, scaling things, the junction depth goes down and the dimensions also X and Y goes down for source drain. So resistance actually increases. The leakage currents also increases because of variety of leakage mechanisms, including diode leakage, gate induced leakage, or what is called Gödel, that gate tunneling effects, band to band tunneling, and n number of high field injection problems. So there are huge problems in leakage currents, so they normally enhance when you scale. However, as I say, these are not the only effects which we are worried about. In digital course someone must tell you, or in devices course someone must tell you much more on that. VT always reduces with channel lengths, think of it. Okay, for a device we padho bhai, the first and the foremost effect, a absolute terms, leakage current absolutely increases enormously. In fact, some of the leakage currents are exponential, and that's our worries. The leakage, of course, as I said, this is not a digital course, but just to give an idea what you are saying, or for all high performance circuits, we are interested in what we call on to off ratio. On currents hardly increase, but the off currents, which is the leak part of which is 90% leakage, increases enormously. So our worry starts that, once I said you also that why we allow students to continue listen, because off power is larger than on power. Okay. So therefore it is better if you use rather than keep it in standby. Okay. This is of course a fun part in that, don't go by that. Okay, so let's, for us which is immediate of interest is this, as I said, there is an increase of source and drain resistance. Drain resistance of course can be taken care through the load value. So you can say even if 10 ohms increase there, the loads are 40 kilo ohms or 10 kilo ohms and above. So that series resistance, that doesn't matter as much. Whereas in the source side, if you see a resistance, what it strikes you immediately, if there is a source resistance in an amplifier, what does it do? It reduces the gain drastically. Is that correct? It is called source degeneration. So the first problem comes when the short channel device is used, there is a source resistance now and it enhances as channel length goes down further. And because of that, there is a source degeneration effect which reduces the gain of a DFAM. Okay. This is an issue which otherwise in a long channel we may not worry about. Okay. I will not derive the expression which follows soon. We define a term, current difference between this and this, IOD is defined as IDS1 minus IDS2, which is essentially GMVID, where VGS1, VGS2 can be explained in this expressions. And we can now see for this node, VG1 minus VGS1 minus IDSRX is equal to VG2 minus IDRX minus VG2 is essentially equal because this point doesn't move. Okay. So this is an equations which now you may have to use in your evaluations. Is that clear? And the major effect, as I say, is instead of doing all of it again, is source resistance in an amplifier is 1 plus GMRS times the gain may go down. Okay. That's the feedback effect, in fact, you will see. Okay. Is that okay, Raj? So this is a typical expression. You can look into books. Of course, Zardavi doesn't have. Some other books, I don't recollect. The ratio of the difference current of the two arms divided by ISS, net current which current source supplies, can be expressed in a Taylor series, which is VID by VOV minus 1 by 8 VID cube by VOV plus other higher terms. Since VID by VOV is smaller, since denominator increases in short channel case, differential amplifier with RSX will show better linear characteristics. That's fantastic because then it will actually, if we see the terms, this term will be even smaller because now, so you will actually come closer to linearity. So one of the advantages of having source degeneration at the cost of gain is your linearity improves. So it's something, everything is not going wrong as we think so. Okay. But if IDRS drops will also reduce GM because the available current, available voltage to you is smaller. So essentially GM at a given current will also actually reduce. Okay. However, please remember what is our design parameter all through. As I say, though I have written expression in terms of VOV, but what should be our design spec on GM by IDS. So if you look at this GM by IDS term, so we said last time, and as I say, GM by IDS is now 1 upon 1 plus GSRX 2 by VOV and not just 2 by VOV as we thought, or if we calculate VOV, this can be in this term. So substituting this in IOD ISS expression for long and short channels, I already divide 1 upon VOE is this expression, or this expression is GM by 2 IDS. Okay, so if GM by IDS is our design parameter, which we are going to have, why did I say that VOV is not a good parameter of design? Because VGS minus VT is excess voltage, which can be chosen by any number or can vary any time. So instead of that, we prefer to have something which is more rigid, which is GM by IDS ratio. Okay. Okay. So we say all that I am trying to get the expression for 1 plus GMRSX VOV is equal to GM by 2 IDS. And if I substitute this expression in the IOD expression both for long channel and short channel. So if I substitute for both this 1 upon GMRS RX into this expression for long channel and short channel, for a long channel it becomes half GM by IDS VID minus 1 by 8 half GM by IDS VID to the power cube. And in a short channel case, IODS by ISS will now become GM by 2 ISVID minus 1 upon 8 1 plus GM RSX VID cube. We now see since this second term has large 1 plus GM RSX divider there, okay, this term will be further smaller. Why it is called cube term is not interesting to us because it is introducing a non-linearity in the IV characteristics essentially. So to make a linearity, this term should be smaller. So by source resistance available, the second term goes down where the first remains same, and therefore we can say that in a short channel device, even with GM by IDS design parameter, linearity will improve with short channel device. So don't feel, you know, everyone always try to curse short channel devices. Of course, digital people don't curse so much because the first thing they look into, or even we should not look so that way, bad way, because the first thing they say is the electron or whole transit time from source to drain will be smaller if the channel length is smaller. Smaller the propagation time, higher is the speed. So for any high speed circuit, the first criteria for me is channel length be as small as possible, preferably zero. Okay. Then everything, what if these devices are called when it is equivalent channel lengths are zero? I thought maybe you have done some seminar these days, RAs. There are devices called tunnel devices or tunnets which do this, this are called also ballistic devices, where typically they have no restriction of movements. Some other day, some other time. So the point I was trying to say that short channel device is better as far as linearity is concerned. The only problem which it may create is the net gain may actually reduce. But gain can be pushed through other means by increasing IDS. But if I increase IDS, power will go. Okay. So there is an issue there. Or if I increase size, the capacitances will increase, so the bandwidth may go down. So there are not that it is so trivial, but at the same time at least swings are larger. So if you are looking for a larger swings, yeah, this is a better device. Okay. Normally what did I say? Channel length should be as high as possible. For what purpose I said? The R out essentially is given by lambda dash by L. Okay. So smaller the channel length, the output resistance is higher, good for gain, GMRO. Okay. So longer length devices always are preferred for high gains. So you think of it now, conditions, where do are you working at, what are you looking at, and therefore correspondingly sizes may be chosen by. Is that design clear to you? This is what designers do. I want this, so what should I do? Okay. Is that okay, all of you? Okay, so now this is something which I last time should have done, I thought I have finished once a while, I thought, but maybe I did not, I don't know. As I say, I am going to talk about the DFAM once again little later with the bandwidth and some other issues which DFAM is creating. Okay. Why I am now worried about DFAM problems? Because DFAM, as I keep saying, is the main gain stage of an operational amplifier, which is our workhorse. So anything I want good from a op-amp, I must get first from DFAM itself. Okay. And any problem which DFAM is showing will automatically a problem for op-amp as well. Okay. So at the end, I am interested in an op-amp design, not really specifically only DFAMs. But I know if I design this properly, I understand what to design, then I also can design op-amp as good, probably. We'll see, there are other issues may come with op-amps, but they are different. First I thought I should finish that, and I also thought I should do frequency response, but I thought that frequency response can wait because we will look into that more specifically from the stability criteria, so we'll club everything there. Right now you assume the bandwidth is essentially given by 1 upon 2 pi R out into CL or CGS or CN, whichever is the value given to you. The other R by RC constant must be not comparable here and therefore neglect. So mostly I am talking of a dominant pole which will be given by one value of the capacitance given. This much you have anyway done in your second year or third year courses. So that much knowledge right now may be sufficient. Please take it, it will have impact in our designs. Last time I showed you values. Bandwidth gives you R out by CL value. CL given to you, it evaluates your R out. R out gives you lengths and IDS. And therefore, this IDS has another limit coming from given bandwidths. Okay, is that clear? So don't ask me that I have not taught that. I have taught in an indirect way. Okay. Okay, so here is the new chapter, which new area we want to start, because these are required in normal OPAM or DFAM designs. So I thought I'll first do that. Few things which are a basic blocks in any analog block, analog circuit or analog IC, is how to bias. Okay. And one of the strongest way of biasing those circuit we suggested is through a current sources. And so we'll like to see which are these current sources or current sinks. What, how do you differentiate between a source and a sink? If it starts from power supply, then we say it's sourced. If it goes to the ground, it's called sink. Basically, they are not very different, but just for the sake of clarity, anything which current enters the ground, then it is a sink. If current emanates from the power supply, then it's called source. They are identical in values many times. The same current may go down, but just to get where do I put that source, current source as such, may be called source or sink. Theoretically, it doesn't matter, but principally one should know where is placement going on. Okay. So, as I said, in most analog ICs, you need current sources. The major requirement for a good current source is its output impedance. Okay, I'll enter here. The first is you need R out as large as possible, preferably infinite if it is ideal source, otherwise as high as possible. We also should see that to keep devices in saturation, the output swings are limited. If you have too much output swing, you may go out of saturation regions. So a current source, when you design, you must see that you are always in, device should remain in saturation. Why do I say current source is a saturated device? Because saturated current of a transistor is beta by 2 W, beta by 2 into VGS minus VT, or VOV square into 1 plus lambda VDS. So VOV square, square means it is a square law term, and therefore we say, and if VDS, lambda is very, very small, the current is constant. Okay, current is constant, therefore it is called current source or sink. So device must remain in saturation if you want a current source. So many times this swing which you are actually expecting in your DFAMs or many other places is limited because this current source may not remain current source there. Okay. And therefore this has to be very limited, of course too far away normal ranges, but you must keep in mind. And third and the foremost is V minimum. What is this? Why I am worried about V minimum? What does that mean? Normally we say that the diode, for example, has a cut-in voltage of 0.6. So what does that mean? That till that voltage is reached in false bias, no current flows. Is that? So if V min is the drop across the current source, firstly it will take VDD minus this much available to you downwards. Is that clear? That means it is also now consuming power, okay, because there is a V drop there, it is consuming power. So to minimize power, and you want to have an ideal current source is what? See, if I plot IDS versus VDS, I would expect IDS versus V, whatever, if I draw if a good current source, I will like something like this. Okay. But in real life, okay, something like this happened, and this value is V min. Is that okay? Ideally, what do I want? Like this, constant current source. Okay. So I must minimize V minimum as much as possible. In reality, zero it cannot be made because device will have some drops. But how minimum, how much minimum we can go is the goodness of current source. So how many three parameters to worry about? One is the output resistance, two, swings available to you which makes device remain in saturation, and three, the smaller the V min, better as the current source. Is that correct? So these issues are clear to you. So this, based on this, And I said you already, apart from every other thing, a typical current mirror satisfies many of these requirements directly, sometimes indirectly. I hope that you appreciate what we are talking about, that anything you have already done, but all that I am now trying to show you a repeat of what you did in second year, third year, wherever you were, is design perspective. It's not that this theory was unknown to you, you knew it anyway, as good probably or maybe better than me, but now as a designer what I am looking at. Okay. But to know design we must go through theory a bit again. So let's have a normal current mirror, which is called simple current mirror shown here, which is giving to me a current source of I0 value, which essentially the way I had connected is IDS2 or M2's drain current. There is no connection here, please take it. So it is VDD power supply, I have a resistance R, then I have a transistor M1 whose drain is connected to its gate. The two gates of M1, M2 are also connected, and M2 then has a current which is IDS2, which I declared as my current source, which is, I am creating from mirror. Mirror in the sense, whatever in the first M1 I am having, that is mirrored to M2, that is mirrored to M2, and therefore this name was given current mirror. Since I am connecting gates, so whatever is VGS1 is same as VGS2. If the sources are connected and gates are connected, VGS for both transistors should be same, is that clear? And if their sizes are also same, then what will be same? The currents will be also same, is that clear? If their sizes are also same, I repeat what I say. VGS1 and VGS2 are equal, and if their sizes are also equal by IDS equal to beta dash by 2 W by L, VGS minus VT square. Okay. So we say if VGS is same for both, and we say both transistors have equal currents. Okay. So we have mirrored the current in the first to the two, but we will calculate, they need not be equal and then sizes, so we will just look into it. If they are equal, then of course IDS1 is IDS2 and IDS2 is your I0. Okay. So we have a current source which is proportional to or exactly equal to IDS1. So this is mirror one. However, in case their sizes are not same, which mostly will be, IDS1, now I can calculate the current. Please remember, current in the resistor is the same current in M1. Because there is a gate which does not allow any DC current to flow. So IDS1 is VDD. Please remember, this current in this arm through R is VDD. This is shorted. Okay. This VSS, sometimes this VSS will be 0, otherwise it will be minus value. Okay. So right now the way it is minus of minus, so it will add in fact. Is that clear? Please put VSS either 0 if given or minus of something. So typically what we do, we say dual rail is, let us say I need a total power supply of 3 volts, so VDD I put 1.5, VSS I put minus 1.5. This is called symmetric rails, but it is not compulsory that it should be equal. 2-1 also can be done, 2 minus 1 or minus 2 plus 1 also can be done. There are advantages and very, very poor thinking of poor problems also may appear if we change VDD to VSS. If it is not symmetric, the analysis becomes very complicated. So we normally always, all books, all teachers will take it simple solutions and maybe ask you what happens if they are not equal. So this minus this subtracted by one of the VGS. So VDD plus VSS, you can say add in numbers, minus VGS 1 by R is the current flowing in this. But this current in the transistor is beta dash by 2 W by L VGS minus VT square 1 plus lambda VDS1. Okay. By logic of same this, IDS2 is beta dash by W2 by L2 VGS2 minus VT2. Now if the transistors are not identical, VT1, VT2 will also be different, so as sometimes even lambdas may be different. But right now assume that lambda dash by L, L is say common for both devices, which is generally the trend. So I am not using separate lambda, but otherwise you should use separate lambda as well. Okay. And of course, as I say, IDS2 is the current source which I am looking for I0. So I have two equations, IDS1 and IDS2. So I take a ratio of IDS1 by IDS2, or sorry, IDS2 by IDS1, because my IDS2 is my outputs. So I take a ratio of, with reference to IDS1, what is my I0, yes, is that okay? I mean, this is what you have done, so this is just to replicate what I said. So if I divide the equations, IDS2 by IDS1 is I0 upon IDS1, which is equal to W2 by L2 divided by W1 by L1, beta 2 dash beta 1 dash. Mu Cox is also right now kept separate. In case they are there, you just cancel that. They are same, you can cancel that. Why I did this? Because there may be some p channel devices sometime may come somewhere. So we do not want to right now write anything, but generally they will be cancelling. VTs, if both are n channel in the same process of same channel length nodes, then beta 2 dash will be equal to beta 1 dash. Also VT2 will be equal to VT1. Okay. Also lambdas are same, and right now assume lambda is extremely small, 0.05 or 0.0. In that case, everything can be cancelled out. VGS1 is anyway equal to VGS2 by force, because you have connected the drain of N1 to the gate of M1, and gate of M1 is same as gate of M2. So VGS1 is always equal to VGS2. If VTs are same, this term cancels. If lambdas are small, then this term cancels. And if betas are equal, this term cancels. So all that I get is the ratio of sizes, W2 by L1 upon W1 by L1. And then I substitute IDS1 value, which I derived as VDD minus VGS1 minus VSS by R. I0 is essentially the ratio of W by L of M2 to M1 multiplied by this current, which is VDD minus VSS minus VGS1 by R. So if I want to design a current of value particularly, what I will fix? I will fix R. Okay, I will fix R. I can also fix VGS1 through which term? VGS1 minus VT is what? VOE. So I can fix excess voltage a priori. I say, okay, 200 millivolt, 300 millivolt. VTs are given to me, which I do not fix, but they are given to me. So I actually know what is my VGS1. Okay. Supply I am going to fix anyway for the technology I am given. So 2.5 minus 2.5 for a 5 micron 5 volt technology. Typically this will be, why I am talking of 5 volt 5 micron, because much of the problems which they are solved better in actual design are given in Boyce and Baker's book. Okay, Lee, Boyce and Baker, they are one of the very good hardware engineering books. Of course, there are two books, the latest version of Baker is also appearing. And if you see them, they are given the real life values. Of course, the only thing they did not want to show you the 0.25 or 0.18 micron results, which new book of Baker has shown some of them. But old ones they wanted to keep because of the problems of the security or something. They are all data given is only 5 micron, 5 volt process. Since I may solve some problem from there, so I thought I will keep this value. But any other value, data must be given to me. Okay. Like for example, if a 0.25 or 0.18, VOV is normally taken 200 millivolts. Okay. But for higher, it can be 0.4. Okay. So it is not that this number is fixed. This is what you design based on your power supplies. Okay. What is the criteria for that? The device should remain saturation irrespective, because there is sufficient headroom must be available for me to keep device. So this value is also not very fixed. You can actually take some value around and use that also. Okay. Is that point clear? Typically, as I say, for most analog designs which we do at 0.13, 0.18, 0.2, even or not 13, 0.18, we use this value of 200 millivolts. Okay. This is typical value. Please do not think it, over one of my student has taken 0.25, you know, that 250 micro millivolt he might have chosen, because he must have figured out that by doing this he is now going for lesser headrooms. Fair enough, doesn't matter, but at least he is keeping device guaranteedly in saturation. So that may be his choice. Okay, so if I want to calculate, therefore I can, if I then fix the ratio of W by L2 to 1, 1 of course I will fix, what should be 1, W by L by 1, normally the minimum W by L 1 is 1 you can use. You can use 5 micron by 5 microns as for a 5 micron process, but this is 1, and this then you accordingly put 10 micron by 5 micron, 20 micron by 5 micron, depends on the increase you want to go beyond this. Typically what is an R out for this circuit? The current source shunting R out is nothing but lambda IDS2, okay, which is 1 upon lambda I0, and many a times, please take it, 1 upon lambda is used as early voltage. So VA by, and by units it is correct, V by I is resistance. So if given instead of lambda, I may specify you an early voltage, I am specifying you lambda indirectly. Is that clear to you? So if also I give you lambda dash, then I am actually specifying the lengths. Okay. So how do designers look at the way? Given a value, he actually has access to other parameters. Okay. So typically you can see if this is in the order of microamps, this will be order of 50 to 100 volts. So you can see this will be order of mega ohms or above, okay, tens of mega ohms. Tens of mega ohms is not extraordinarily large resistance compared to infinite, which you would have liked to, okay, but even then relatively much enough, good enough for normal use, okay. Is that okay? So this is a good current source we thought, but in reality we will say it is not that good. Because if we calculate the V min for this, which we will do later, then you will figure out that this is not that great, okay. Is that okay, Raj? Everyone written? Okay, here is some example which I am using on maps. Quickly, VT 0.6 volt, lambda 0.06, VOV 200 millivolt. Supply voltage is 1.5 minus 1.5 VSS, IDS1 is 10 microamps. So what is VGS1 now? I assume VOV as 0.2 volt or 200 millivolts. So VGS1 is 0.6 plus 0.2. Is that okay? How do I get my VGS1? VOV plus VT. Okay. Since I am given a current in the first arm as 10 microamps, I can calculate the resistance used as VDD minus VSS minus VGS1 by IDS1, which is around 220 kilo ohms. Okay. Essentially saying if I have a 2.5 supply, I put 220 k as the resistor there, the drain current of M1 is 10 microamps. Is that clear? 10 microamps. And I then calculate, in a technology it is normally fixed. You are right, your point is right. In our case same, because VGS1 is same, okay, so we assume it is the, VTs are also same, so VO is also same. Okay. If they are not equal then you can use differently, but in a technology it is very difficult to change VOEs. Okay. Normally for keeping a transistor on saturation, some value is fixed for all of them. For P channel it may be different from N channel, for all N channel will have same VOV. Okay. If you have seen my earlier graphs, it does vary, but then you have to find optimum VOV there. If you have to plot it and figure out what VOV I should use. If you see your earlier notes, we have shown you if it varies, what do we do? Okay. Figure it out. See, analytically if you keep varying, then you cannot analytically solve, then you have to go numerically or plots. Graphic is essentially numerical solution. So if you do numerically, you will get exactly, but if I do analytically, my assumption has to be something which I can evaluate. Okay. Okay. So if I0 is 10 microamps, then beta dash by 2 W by L2 VGS minus VT, VTs are equal, let us say, then Then I substitute all of it here and evaluate W by L2, which is by 50 by 11, which is around 4.54 microns. It's taken from that technology is 110 microamp per volt square. I think, have I not written here? Okay, maybe this is written here. The 100 and for n channel, this value also will be specified to you. Okay, for a technology, mu c aux will be given to you. Okay. Typical value for 0.25 or 0.35 is 110 microamps per volt square is the beta dash values. This is typical data is taken for 0.25 micron process. Okay. Why I am insisting on 0.25 as much? Because most of the analog blocks will be designed on 0.25 or 0.18. Okay. But if they are mixed signal, which technology they will have to design? Whatever digital is asking, I do not have any choice. Okay. They say 90 nanometers, they say 11 nanometers, I will have to design all of it for that technology. But if I am only doing an op-amp for my own sake, or comparators I want to market on for board use, then I can design on 0.25. As I say, scaling has some advantages, but it actually reduces the gain. So we preferably to have little larger technology node, but not too large, because then it creates huge power losses. So we are trying to manipulate that. So most analog chips which are marketed will be either on 0.25 or 0.18. Some may be on 130 nanometers, but rarely on 90 nanometers. Please do not think there are some analog devices chips which are on 90 nanometers, but in general I will say, almost all op-amps which you see, except ADS576 or that kind, all of them are typically on 0.25 process. Okay. But if op-amp is a part of a digital network, some system, then it will have to be designed at that. And you will be surprised that gain of 10 to power 6 is unthinkable there. Okay. So then you have to really worried about how best you can get solutions there. Okay. So think of it, R out, if I give a lambda, so I get 1.66 megaohms. If I choose length 0.25, typically around 1.25 micron widths are good enough for W2, and you can evaluate, you can get your source. We must guarantee VDS2 should be VGS2 minus VT for saturation. Therefore, VDS2 must exceed 200 millivolts. Okay, because then only we can say it remains in saturation. Okay, here is some interesting features, how mirrors are used. The mirrors are used to create currents in different arms. So it need not be of the same current in different places. So I may actually have this R M1 based calculation to give me IDS1, and then I can have W by L differently for M2, M3. As long as I connect their gates, VGS1 is equal to VGS2 equal to VGS3. Okay, and in that case, the ratio of this to this W by L, ratio of this to this W by L will give you the current proportional to IDS1. So it is IDS2 by IDS1 will be 2, IDS3 by IDS1 will be 4, if these are the sizes. So it will flow 10 microamp, 20 microamp, 40 microamps currents here. As I said, these currents are actually sinking, you know, because the currents are going towards ground. Okay. If you want to create a source kind, a p-channel devices can be used. Okay. Is that Raj clear? In n-channel, current is going to the ground. If I had to take up from power supply, I must create a current source which we can then use it only a p-channel device. I have two, if I have a p-channel device, then I can have gates connected to drain of M1 as they were, and then R is grounded and this is your VDD. So current here and current here is the ratio of W by L of M2 to W by L of M1, same as n channels. Okay. Is that clear? Now I will give an example why I use this many times. It is called sourcing combinations. So is that clear? This is source and these are sinks. You need not call it that way, but the current entering ground is sinks, current coming from power supply is called source. This is a nomenclature, need not be very seriously worried about it. Okay, is that figure clear to you? So n channel device, I can create current mirrors. So far if you want further currents elsewhere, what should I do? Extend this gate ahead. Put another transistor of different W by L if you need, yeah, current of that proportional to this, the third arm. Okay, keep doing this as many as you want. Why we can guarantee M2s are always in saturation of this M2? Because VGS1 and VGS2 are always connected to gate. Therefore, if one is in saturation, the other has to be in saturation. Here is something which you should learn, because this is what, No, it does not, because VGS1 and VGS2 is decided by this minus this one time only. This value minus this is this value. Is that clear? So that is one time decision. R will decide how much is you are actually getting. Is that correct? For a given this, this minus IR plus VSS is the all that the VGS will be, okay, which is getting fixed anyway through R. This another issue which many designs will require is the following. Is that okay? This, Raj? VDS2, why should it vary? VDS2 will be always equal to VGS2, will prove it. Okay. It is always at the edge of saturation. We will come and show you. Whichever is the current there, it will always be equal to VDS2, will be VGS2. Just check it. So that device is permanently in saturation. Okay, here is a method of transferring currents. You create an n-channel current mirror which is sink kind, and then you want to transfer on a p-channel device as a source current. Okay, so you have another p-channel source area, and please remember, now I do not need R there. What is that R was giving you anyway? Current. So this current of IDS2 is acting like a source current or the bias current for this mirror. Okay. So if you want further go down for another n channel requirements ahead, you bring this instead of R, now same current can go to the next n channel block and you can run through. So what can I do? For example, this is 10, let us say this is 10, and for say reasons, this is double the size, this is 20, let us say this is 40. Now this is 40, and if I double it, this is 80. So do not jump from 10 to 80 in one go. Is that correct? Do not jump. That means do not put W by L 2 equal to 8 here to make it 8 times current. Why? What is the problem if I make W by L 8 times? Okay, what is the problem? No, the major worry probably is the capacitance is there. Is that correct? Capacitance is there. The another problem is in layouts, as we call. What is layout issue? Layout means sizing if you do. What is the aspect ratio, do you know? Length and width. Length by width is called aspect ratio. If something is aspect ratio is like this and some is like this, then any drawing scheme will make error on one or the other. Is that correct? So typically devices should be of same aspect ratio or close aspect ratio. Is that point clear to you? This is graphic problem, not really a problem of device. But graphically, when I etch a line which is 0.1 micron and 20 micron length, I will have much more errors to maintain, get to that length all about 0.1 everywhere. Instead, if I have 1.1, 1.1 and accordingly adjust, then I can get more accurately the ratios which I am looking for. Is that clear? This is called graphic problems on chip. Okay, and therefore layouts, when you draw, you do not put larger device in one go, parallel them if possible, as many as if you wish to increase W by L. Is that correct? This is essentially paralleling. It also distributes the power, so that it does not consume at one point huge powers. Is that clear to you? So therefore, P to N into P is a normal method of jumping from low currents to high currents. Is that clear to you? Please take it that if you make a spice simulation with 8 and you get and you extract and it comes back, don't get satisfied because you have not done thermal analysis. In actual chip, that thermal part will appear anyway, okay, whether you like or not. So the chip may on the circuit may work, but in real life it may not, or as good, okay, I won't say it will not. And therefore, these issues should be thought a priori, okay. So these are design issues. This is nothing to do with actual mirror. Mirror could have been simple, whatever ratio you want. But in design, one must think how many ways you should go so that it is universally acceptable values which you can get, okay. I agree, but 8 fingers still are in parallel capacitance, so they are adding there. Their power heat problem probably is minimized, but the capacitance problem is not minimized because they are at the same node all capacitance. This actually distributes the capacitance. Graphic it can solve. That once you are individual transistor, that is what fingers do, no? That they solve the aspect ratio problem. Okay. But the capacitance at that node is still some of them, okay, whichever you do. Is that okay? Is that okay? Now there is an issue which we must look into before we proceed further. The issue comes that how much is your so called transistor M1, M2 are identical? Because all the mirror was talking is W by ratio only, okay, or VTs were common or this were common. So how much is the mismatch between the two transistors or number of transistors you are going to use will decide some way the accuracy of current mirrors. So what I am saying, if there is a variation, and I have taken a simple case, I am going to solve for a plus minus variation, equal variations, and figure out what is the percentage of variation at the output current if these devices change by so much, let us say 5%. So is the current ratio changes by 5%, 3% error? What is the percentage error if this inaccuracy occur? As a designer, I am now worried because I am shrinking everything and I am worried how much accurately I am doing that. Okay. So this is an issue which, as I say, now has taken into prominence because we have started worrying about inaccuracies. The inaccuracies come from varieties of ways which are called variability issues in process. And they cannot be handled by anyone, okay. These are there, okay. For those who have device background to some extent, there is a fin fed. So there is something called the thickness of the fin. There is also a spacer thickness. There is also the length up to which the spacer ends. There are 7 parameters which we govern on fin fed design. Now which one is dominant? We do not know because all of them may vary with all processes, okay. So nowadays there is an issue which one should be controlled better than compared to all others. And there is an issue which is now worrying every 45 nanometer down people. Okay. One good news, always something goes bad, luck favors you. As you go for 16 nanometers down or 16 or below, the scaling law has changed now. It is not really scaling. Say for example, if you see, this is additional feature, just I will come back. We were thinking that oxide thickness is scaling like this as years. Actually it is not, now it is like this, okay. So much of my worry has actually reduced in 16 nanometers. So game, as I say, happens. People are smarter than the device, but device becomes at the end much smarter, okay. We are trying to understand the process and the circuit relationship, and then the performance of the system, and we are trying to get some kind of what we call thumb rules. What are thumb rules? They are no real legal status, okay. So we say Vt varies by delta Vt by 2, beta dash varies by plus minus delta V dash by 2, lambda varies by delta lambda by 2 for M1 and M2. Is that okay? Figure drawn, values drawn. The next slide will actually explain what I meant. This analysis is not new. This is done many years earlier also. So it is not that I am doing. Only I am doing it for you right now here. This is a very common analysis. And this is not true only for this device. This is true for everywhere. Whichever variation, this is how one solves the sensitivities. Is that okay? Everyone? Okay. So we write based on the analysis, based on the thinking I said, beta 1 dash is beta dash minus delta beta dash by 2, whereas beta 2 dash is beta, say beta dash is an average value over which one is less than delta beta dash by 2, the other is plus delta beta dash. This is only the variation. So what is the net variation? Delta beta dash, but half is given here and half is given there. Okay. Similarly for Vt, similarly for lambda. And now I take the ratio of I0 to IdS1. This is my beta 1 dash, okay, beta 2 dash into VGS minus, right now I am assuming Vt is of this kind, So is that correct? Vt is average value plus delta Vt, because this is subtracted, this is minus, square 1 plus lambda VDS plus delta lambda by 2 VDS. The IDS1 current follows the 1-1 values, so beta dash minus delta beta dash by 2, VGS minus Vt plus 0.5 delta T square, 1 plus lambda VDS minus delta lambda by 2 VDS. Minus comes because this is minus. Okay. I take out this big term out. I take beta dash from here. I take VGS 2 times VGS minus Vt outside here. Okay. And from here I take 1 plus lambda VDS here. From each of them, the first two terms I take out. So that becomes beta dash into 2 VGS minus Vt square plus 1 plus lambda VDS. Now for this, the term when you take beta dash out is 1 plus delta beta dash by 2 beta dash, 1 minus delta Vt upon 4 VGS minus Vt square, 1 plus delta lambda VDS upon 1 plus lambda VDS, and opposite sign correspondingly is this. However, these two values are same. Okay, so they can be cancelled. This is taken only to remove something from denominator and numerator. Okay, is that okay? Just each part, common terms I removed so that I can remove those terms. Is that okay? Is that okay? So, sorry, you can redo yourself if you wish. That the cancels term, after that you get 1 plus delta beta dash by 2 beta, 1 minus delta Vt is this square plus 1 plus this divided by minus signs correspondingly opposites of that. However, 1 minus delta x by x to the power minus 1, if delta x is much smaller by binomial expansions, it can be written roughly equal to 1 plus delta x by x. Okay. So 1 minus delta beta h, what I am doing it now, ye jo niche wala term hai, isko main upar kar deta hun. So I get I0 upon IDS1 is 1 plus delta beta h by 2 beta h square, 1 minus delta Vt upon this to the power 4 into 1 plus lambda Vds. Assumption is, the delta terms are much smaller, which is why they are called deltas, and binomial expansion is valid. Okay. All higher terms are neglected. Then I expand square terms. Something square I can write a square plus b square plus 2ab or minus 2ab, whichever is a minus b or a plus b. So I expand this, I expand this, I expand this. Okay. Then what did I say? What can I say? If delta is small, all delta square term is still smaller. So, usko bhi chhod denge. Ya kis liye kiya ja raha hai? To kuch number simplify expression dikh jaye isliye aur kuch nahi. You do yourself and verify. But this whole trick I am using is to prove that if I want to calculate, I should get a very simple expression. So, ya delta square terms are neglected by me. As I say, these numbers should be maybe right also. Just check the numbers. If there are 2, just use 2. If there are 4, use 4. Okay. Koi bada maths nahi hai, sirf usko expand kiya hua hai. ए प्लस बी और ए माइनस बी का स्क्वायर किया गया है, ए स्क्वायर प्लस बी स्क्वायर माइनस टू ए बी और प्लस टू ए बी, नथिंग ग्रेट, नो मैथ्स, इज दैट ओके ऑल ऑफ यू? सो इफ आई डू दैट आई निग्लेक्ट दोस दिस टर्म आई गेट दिस एक्सप्रेशन. लॉट ऑफ गेम आई प्ले, यू लुक एट दिस लास्ट बिफोर यू राइट द फर्स्ट लाइन, वन प्लस टू लैम टू डेल्टा लैमडा वी डी एस बाय वन प्लस लैमडा वी डी एस. आई से ओके लैमडा वी डी एस इज नॉर्मली लार्जर देन वन, वी डी एस इज मोर, सो आई निग्लेक्ट वन. एंड इफ आई निग्लेक्ट वन आई कैन रिमूव वी डी एस, देन आई से आई गेट वन प्लस टू डेल्टा लैमडा बाय लैमडा, बट डेल्टा लैमडा बाय लैमडा इज वेरी स्मॉल, सो आई निग्लेक्ट दैट ऑल्सो. नो यू कैन कीप दैम, बट दिस इज हाउ आई क्विक कैलकुलेशन. इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डू हाउ मच यू विल फिगर इट आउट, हाउ डू आई डू? ओके, सो इफ आई कीप डूइंग दिस एनालिसिस, I expand this, I multiply these two terms, this I became, I remove it because I say 1 plus 2 lambda by lambda is 1. So I get final expression is, you can write by then, just see it, 1 plus delta beta dash by beta dash minus delta Vt Vgs minus Vt minus delta beta dash by beta delta Vt upon this, okay. If I take delta Vt by Vt out, delta like doing this delta beta this, why I write delta Vt by dt delta, what is that way I am telling, then the percentage I can actually declare. So I just do tricks on that. So to say, if you have function variation within plus minus 5%, the I0 to IDS ratio will be within 4% of error. These are for a specific values. You may get more or less, depends on VGS minus VT you use, and only VGS minus VT you use. Okay. Yes, dominant. ये दूसरी दो term minus में है ना, इसलिए थोड़ा कम हो रहा है, वो अकेली term plus है वहाँ पर, तो पाँच इसीलिए बोला ना 5% वहाँ है, तो एक आध परसेंट बाकी का दे दो तो 4% रह जाता है. You got it? This may be 5%, this may be totally 1%. So 4% error you are going to get if 5% error you see in the VTs or in sizes or in betas. Is that okay? So this is how one evaluates the errors, because this is something very crucial, how much accuracy I am holding when I say I am mirroring it. Is that clear? How much accurately I am mirroring it. So these numbers are not really great or something, just to tell you that don't believe that exactly it transfers, it does not, okay, and depends on the values, it may be even more or sometimes even less, okay. Is that okay? So we'll continue with this.